I have a great deal of compassion for those that have gone on before us. I embrace the world of ghosts. Unlike some that tend to demonize them, we have to take into consideration that they were people just like you and just like me that lost their lives tragically, violently, and untimely. So the next time you think in terms of ghosts, don't think in terms of evil, negative beings. Over the years, I've encountered a number of ghost researchers, and everyone's entitled to their opinion and their perspective as to the nature of what a ghost is, but you take this into consideration. Everything in life evolves. Everything makes progress. Why not ghost research? Why do so many of us do it the way Grandma and Grandpa did it many years ago? If you read a book dated 50 years ago with the technology of 50 years ago, and you tried to apply that to today's technology, wouldn't you feel a little foolish? Correct? Right? So remember, ghost research is progressive. My approach is very progressive. Any questions? Any questions? No. So anyhow, some researchers I've seen in some areas, and they'll walk into an area and they'll say, and I'm not putting anybody down, because there is a definite learning plan. Yeah, we got more chairs coming. Because this is a very definite learning process. But when you're fearful of going into some areas, consider one thing: that knowledge of what's there and identity of what's there. Once you know what's there, knowledge and identity takes the sting of fear. And I believe that it is our ignorance and fear that limits our ability to proceed more aggressively in trying to identify anomalous or ghost activity here on the ship or anywhere for that matter. Make sense? Okay. So, some ghost researchers will go into an area and they'll say, gosh, it's dark here. It's negative here. I don't want to be here. It's too evil. It's too cool. You know what? If you can't cook, stay out of the kitchen. Because if you change it from being dark and evil to warm and fuzzy, like people, most ghosts are friendly. 99%, let me reiterate, 99% of the ghosts on this ship are friendly. There are no dark, evil, negative ghosts on this ship. If you hear that, change it around. Put some light around it. See, I use thought-provoking comments when I speak to raise consciousness and get you to think a bit about this. The fact that there are people that lost their lives here. So, I know, Paul.
Good.
Okay. Now, let's get to some juicy stuff. And I want to preface this by saying some of my stuff might be a little bit redundant, but it's important that you understand what I'm coming from, where I'm coming from. Let's talk about the beat down. 1991, when I was here for Disney had a tour called Ghosts, Myths, and Legends. And everything was operated by the switch of a computer. You went into the pool and the pool would fog up. You went to room B340, by the way, which is alleged to be haunted. In my opinion, it's a joke. And I say that being respectful of other ghost researchers here. Okay? And they claim that no one can stain the room because the blankets are pulled off the bed. I say it's a farce. When I was here, you walked in the room in 1991, and the door would open and close, and I would switch to the computer, and the moans and groans and blood stains on the carpeting. In my opinion, it's a joke. But that's up to you to decide. Okay? However, they talk about D deck as being the most haunted deck on the ship. Contrary to that, the entire ship is haunted. And one of the most common phenomena that happens is that a ghost walks through every stateroom, every suite on the ship. So one doesn't have to be psychic or intuitive to visually see or sense these entities. Does that make sense to any of you? Okay. So, B-Deck room, now the real haunted room in B-Deck, in my opinion, is B-474. In 1959, when the ship was afloat, there was a family of four, father, mother, and two little girls. For some unknown reason, the father went berserk, strangled his wife and two little girls with ligatures, and they were found lying on the bed. They died. Little girls were 4 and 2, named Dana and Penny. And the father was found in the bathroom, who was dying from a self-inflicted gunshot wound. He bled to death. So this is the room that's truly haunted, not the 340. Also, there's another room on the very, I forget the number of the room, but on the very end of B deck going toward the isolation ward. The room on the left-hand side going toward the door that you open. Many years ago, while the ship was afloat in the 50s, there was a lady of the night there, who's doing business there. That's a lot of good, okay? Anyhow, they found her with her throat slashed, and she was murdered in that room. So that room is also haunted. And speaking of the isolation ward during the Second World War, there were many prisoners of war as young as 16, 17 years old, both German and Italian. These young prisoners chose to commit suicide rather than to face the consequences of remaining a prisoner of war. Therefore, the isolation ward is quite active with moans and groans and many disembodied voices. And when I begin my tours next month, I'm very happy to take you there. But let me talk about the most infamous ghost on the ship is my talking child ghost, Jackie. After meeting up with Jackie in the Royal Theater, I ended up meeting her in the first class swimming pool, and we had an interactive, audible conversation that was all what I'm getting to say, witnessed by scores of people over the years, including many of the premiering executives. And by the way, I'm not going to push my DVD, but if you want to see this on my DVD, it's being sold in the exhibit hall, where you hear Jackie talk. So, and every time I do my ghost voice, Jackie will either giggle, or she'll speak, or she'll make some kind of an utterance. Would you agree? Let me take my tours. Anyway, this is the most interesting. Also, Mr. Captain Jones that speaks audibly down in the chat alley area. And the first recorded death on the ship was that of Captain Edgar Britton, who died during the first year of his manning the ship in 1933, having been replaced. Captain Britton is seen frequently in the propeller box room. which is directly across from the Royal Theater. It's a very, very active place. So if you go there, you might say hi to Pat. He also speaks oddly. Now, there's a ghost or two in the boiler room. When the Queen Mary was first built in 1929-30, they had a crew of 10,000 men that were building the ship. However, a year later, the Great Depression came in, they ran out of funds, and 10,000 workers left Clyde's Bank, England, or Scotland, and went back to their home. However, two remained with the skeleton of the ship. And then in 1934, when they got money to rebuild the ship, and they looked into the double bottom of the ship, they discovered two skeletal remains. And in my opinion, these are the two that died on the Queen Mary. And one of them identifies himself as John Henry. John Henry can be heard and seen in the boiler room. And ladies, if you were in there, he loves ladies. So if you were in there tonight and you feel him touch the top of the air or your shoulder, just say hi to John Henry. Okay, yes? Yes. Well, first of all, when I see a ghost, I have yet to see any feet. I never see feet. So how they get around, you know, I don't have all the answers. But when I see a ghost, I never see them. I see them from the knees up. And how they get around is this way, in my opinion. Because we are made up basically of electromagnetic energy, when we die, we maintain a certain amount of electromagnetic energy. And within the ghost vehicle, if you will, and how the thing that enables them to cause evidential physicality is that they sort of conjure up or rob, if you will, from light fixtures, from machinery, from your camera batteries, and the more electromagnetic energy they're able to conjure up, the more they're enabled to show themselves from a transparent form to a full figural materialization. Make sense? Fuck, okay. It's hot in here. Anyhow, how many of them are from sighting things? I'm doing more investigation very, very soon. Yes?
Yes. Obviously, these people that have die tragically or untimely are stuck in this never-never land of dimension. Do you ever try to get them unstuck so they can move on?
I'm always respectful of the term stuck. In my opinion, ghosts are territorial. They remain where they die, or they'll go to places that are familiar, comfortable, or meaningful to them. Remember, most ghosts are not aware of being dead. So it's, and what they do is, they do the very last thing they did just prior to death in a never-ending cyclical fashion. Over, it is so redundant. And some ghosts will interact with you, and some ghosts are totally oblivious to our being there. But I don't believe that any ghost is stuck. For example, when I did my 8 years of sightings, I was never given any information as to my destination or the nature of the activity or circumstances or gender. So it was never my responsibility to get them to move on. However, when you go into a haunted house and someone dies there, and you go into their space, then they'll let you know that you're invading their space somehow. But you can coexist. You can establish a rapport. And it's not by burning incense, not by burning sage, but simply saying, "Hi, John. I'm your new buddy. I'm moving in." Yes, every ship, every hospital has a heart. And I believe swimming pool is a heart of ship. And that's where the main vortex is. And when I do my tours, if you want to come and see me sometime, I'll let you experience the vortex. A vortex is basically an energy center. It's a place, it's like a portal to the other side of dimension. It's where they energize themselves, the entrance to and from the vortex. The vortex is always about 10 to 20 degrees colder than the surrounding area. And some people feel dizzy in it, some people feel not making a vortex. So there are many vortices throughout the ship, but the main one is in the middle. Yes. Not necessarily him, because he didn't die there, but you can clearly smell cigar smoke. And when I was here in 91, I had that sleep regularly. And the doors would open and close, and the TV would go off and on, I would run up there. And the cabin doors, about 2 o'clock in the morning, everything went really wild there. But I'm never unnerved by this. We should never be afraid of ghosts. Someone tell me why. Yes?
Yeah. Can I just ask a question? You're speaking of the vortexes. Does that cause us like a feeling like your head's swimming?
Yes, it can cause any number of things. A vortex is also categorized as a rip in the fabric of time, if you will. Okay? So a vortex, they're all quite interesting. But let me tell you another story. Yes. Jackie is about 4 years old. She has dark hair. I've seen her in little pigtail, little curls, and with a dress that dates back to maybe 60 more years ago. So this is what Jackie looks like in my opinion. But Jackie talks audibly to everybody. How many remember the Harlem Ghost from Sightings? With all the scratching.
Oh, yeah.
That. Yeah. I was on TV recently on Discovery Channel where they reinvestigated that haunting because it was so extraordinary. Sightings did 16 segments of that particular haunting because it was so extraordinary. I did 6 of the 16. I was the one that identified Sally, the one that did all the scratching. And so after being there 6 times, Atchison, Kansas, it's a town about as big as this room. So the town folk, being all farmers, respectfully, you know, they take all the grain. So I said, Peter, how about doing a lecture for it before you leave? So one Saturday night, they gathered the town folk in a hall about, maybe twice as big as this, about 500 people. So I was talking about the nature of the ghost activity, which really intrigued them. Of course, most of them were non-believers. So I said, by a show of hands, how many believe in ghosts? To the audience back in Kansas years ago. And everybody was reluctant to raise their hand, but not 20 people raised their hand, they don't want me to be guilty. I said, fine. I said, how many have ever seen a ghost by raising their hands? They raised their hands. Then I said, how many have ever had sex with a ghost? this happens. So way back at this wall, this little man says, yeah, me. I said, sir, would you come up and talk to us? So he comes up all excited about it. I said, sir, would you explain to our audience what it was like having sex with a ghost? He said, oh, I thought you said a ghost.
Oh,
programs exist where? Dating back to 2,000 years ago. Dating back to biblical times. And I'm respectful of the Bible and its teachings. However, in my opinion, the Bible, I'm not going to talk religion, but the Bible was written in symbolic, allegorical language, which means some of the things are not to be believed literally about demons. We're talking about demons, kind of demons. We're talking human beings. Demons, where do they come from? 2,000 years ago, when someone fell ill or acted strangely because of their pre-scientific explanation for natural phenomena and diseases, they didn't understand what was going on. This person who was unconscious or mentally disturbed, they got sage and incense, they did all kinds of things, right? So, they believed in a mythical, folkloristic elements that were used to ward off these evil, possessing, demonic spirits. I do not believe in the existence of demons. I've never seen one. What do they look like? Let's see one. Okay. In my opinion, demons do not exist. They exist from many, many years ago. I learned almost 40 years ago from my teachers, who learned from their teachers, who learned from their teachers, and they all learned from hearsay. And it's virtually unchanged almost 50 years later. That's why I'm saying we have to come up with your notches. You can wait to be done today by the CDK. Yes?
Okay, so I'm just trying to clarify where you're
So this is what, as an investigator, this is what you have to remember. On the Queen Mary, for any place that you investigate, there has to be a verifiable connection, a history of that person having lived there prior to their death. Makes sense? Anybody else? Okay. I'm about to wrap up, folks. I can't say how much I appreciate you coming out. When I leave here, I'm going down to the exhibit hall where my booth is. So if anybody wants to say hi to me there, please remember, I don't shake hands, so forgive me, but I'm too loud. And any other questions? Yeah, you want to take a picture of me? Yeah.